Well, good morning, everybody. And welcome to worship here at Bethlehem Lutheran Church. Today is a great day. We are celebrating Reformation Day. We're also celebrating Confirmation. So welcome, families. Welcome, guests. It's great that you are here. So at Bethlehem, we welcome you just as you are for who you are. This week could have been fantastic for you. This week could have been awful, but it doesn't matter because in this place, you can be you, bring the best and worst of yourself because God meets us with grace, compassion, mercy, and love just as we are for who we are. Bethlehem's mission, our reason for being, is to build a community of people who follow in the way of Jesus as we worship, pray, learn, give, and serve together. And the stories that we tell ourselves, they matter because they shape how we see ourselves, the world, and our community, as well as giving us a sense of identity. So we have stories to share, but we have to be intentional about that. And so again, today we are celebrating with 27 of our families as they affirm the promises made to them in baptism. Also, speaking of music, music is an important part of how we tell our story. And for those of you who have Bethlehem as your community of faith, you have two options for going deeper into the life of our music as we tell that story. We're looking to purchase a supplement to our current worship material. You can purchase that in the square in memory of somebody if you would like. Also, coming up on November 7th, if you would like to learn more about the bell choir that we have here, it's a great choir to be a part of. They do a lot of great things. And if you've ever wondered how in the world do they do that, can I even make a sound on this bell? I've always wanted to do this, but I've never had the opportunity or maybe the courage to try. Well, they're inviting you on November 7th to come check it out, to actually pick up the bells, make the noise, and ask any question that you might have as they are recruiting for the bell choir. And also then parents, our communion milestone is coming up this Friday. There is still time to sign up. Then, the particular story that we have that gathers us in worship, it also gathers us as a community that cares for one another. And perhaps many of you have heard, hopefully most of you have heard, I am without my colleague right now. So Pastor Stephanie had her baby. Owen was born this week, and everyone is doing well. 2 weeks early, but you know what? That's okay, because honestly, I am relieved that she did not go into labor during worship. That was like a huge concern of mine last week when she led the sharing of the peace as part of our service. She told me, I'm not going to go down the steps. I'm having a hard time breathing. And I'm like, oh God, just please don't go into labor. So she held off another day, and Owen came into the world. And so we celebrate with their family. You will see them out and about in the Bethlehem community. But she will not be back in any official capacity until her maternity leave is over. And then, of course, game night is something else we want to talk about very briefly when it comes to our community. This is born out of a feeling that we need to be connected and enjoy the company of others in just a fun, intentional kind of way. And this is actually the idea of a couple of our members here at Bethlehem, and there's going to be more information coming out about this, even what has led them to want to do this. And so more information will be coming, but again, mark your calendars for mid-November as we begin this intentional community building as part of our congregation. There are a variety of other ways to serve in the life of this community as we follow in the way of Christ. In your bulletin, you will find a variety of other opportunities, and I would encourage you this. Think about how you, individually or as a family, would like to take one step deeper into the life of this community as we live out our mission together. Now, as we turn our attention to worship, we hear a story on how Jesus frees us to be the people that God has called to be, living with intention, with love, with hope, with mercy, and grace. I invite the congregation to rise as you are able as our worship begins in song. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word, protect and comfort them in times of trial, defend them against all enemies of the gospel, and bestow on the church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I invite the congregation to please be seated as we hear God's word for us today.
Today's reading is from Romans chapter 3, 19 through 28, page 134 in the New Testament. Paul's words stand at the heart of the preaching of Martin Luther and other Reformation leaders. No human beings make themselves right with God through works of the law. We are brought into a right relationship with God through the divine activity centered in Christ's death. This act is a gift of grace that liberates us from sin and empowers our faith in Jesus Christ. The reading begins at verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. But by what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite the congregation to rise as you are able as we welcome the gospel reading.
Gospel according to John, chapter 8, page 88 in the New Testament. Jesus speaks of truth and freedom as spiritual realities known through his word. He reveals the truth that sets people free from sin. The reading begins at verse 31. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and that Abraham and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
I invite the congregation to please be seated. All right, so this morning, let's talk about this word, because it comes up in our gospel text today. In today's gospel that Justin just read, Jesus says, "The truth will make you free." Now, if someone were to come up to me and say that statement just out of the blue, just with no context around it, I would be totally turned off by that. First, it's a short, pithy kind of statement, something that a lot of people would like to repost on their social media, Or if you're a bit older, this phrase sounds like it should be included on a bumper sticker. It sounds good, but nobody knows really what you're talking about. Second, not just recently, but for years, I have not had a good relationship with this word, truth. When it comes to this word, I am incredibly jaded and have been for a long time. I mean, it seems that everybody, and I mean everybody, has the truth. Every organization, every institution, every politician, every individual who has an opinion about anything has the truth. And more often than not, these organizations and individuals feel the need to make sure that everyone else, including me, knows the truth, even if it's not based on anything more than just a strong inclination or feeling. I mean, and when everybody has the truth, well, it makes it really hard for anyone to know anything. And it also makes it really hard for anybody to trust people. I mean, I think that's, generally speaking, where we find ourselves a lot in our culture right now. But that's not the entire reason that I struggle with this word. The truth is even more complicated than that. So these days, I find myself listening to a lot of teachers in our community and even right here in our congregation. More than a few of our teachers are telling stories about students who melt down, and I mean melt down, if they do not do well on an assignment. Is that true of any of you guys? Do you melt down or not? No? Good. Well, there's a lot, apparently, who do. And that was true, though, when I was in high school as well. But I think it's even more pronounced today. I mean, I remember asking my teachers, just tell me what I have to do to get an A. I mean, just come on, tell me what I have to do. What do I have to memorize? What do I have to recite? What would you like me to write? What would you like me to say so I can get what I want? And now there are online student groups, both in high school and on the college level, that gives incoming students a heads up about the different classes that they're going to be taking. And so these groups will post things like how many times you need to attend the class in order to get credit, and which assignments are weighted more, and which packets, note packets, are essential for the exams, and how much more or less work is this person expecting as compared to other teachers or professors you might have had. I mean, in this world, no one is concerned about what you learn or what that information means actually for your daily living in life, but it is about the grade. So here's my takeaway. We live in a culture in which entire systems that relate to the truth as simply information to recite without any thought, without any reference to what we are living in and experiencing in life. And here's why I mentioned this. I want you to think about your religious upbringing. I mean, if you had a religious upbringing, I mean, was it honestly any different? I mean, so today, we are celebrating with you as family and friends this service of confirmation, and it is a good thing. And when I did this years ago, and I sat in your spots, confirmation, it wasn't bad, but it was absolutely like school. Reciting information, jumping through hoops. I mean, I did what I had to do in order to make my mom happy, right? I mean, it was not a bad experience because my friends were there, but it was absolutely like school. Faith was just pieces of information that I had to remember for the time that had nothing to do with my actual experience in life as I lived. So, in our world right now, truth, whether that is related to someone's just strong opinion on something, or just a random assortment of details and facts detached from experience, detached from how we live in the world, detached from how we live together, detached from what it means to be human. That's why I have such a hard time with this word. And I don't think I need to say it, but this kind of truth, it's just not life-giving in the least. It's not the deep truth that so many of us are needing and seeking in life. It's not the kind of truth that can give us hope about anything. And so Jesus says in today's reading, if you continue in my word, you are my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And when Jesus says you will know the truth, the word he is using for know, and this is important, it refers actually to first-hand experiences. In other words, Jesus says this, if you are my disciples, Jesus says, if you live in the world in my way, then you will have first-hand experiences of this truth, and this truth will set you free. So what does that look like? Well, when Jesus teaches about forgiveness, he teaches us that there is life beyond ourselves. He teaches us that joy can come through generosity, to move beyond ourselves for the sake of others, because that's what love is. He teaches us to be less condemning, less judgmental. He teaches us to have hope and spend less time worrying about things. We all could use that, I think. He teaches that weakness and an openness to vulnerability are the new strong, and he teaches us how to live in the world in the midst of great suffering and adversity. I mean, if you've been able to forgive at any point in your life, or if you've been forgiven genuinely by someone else, you know it's the better way because you have experienced it. It's not just an idea that you kind of have in your head. If you've been the recipient of the generosity of others, or are working to be more generous yourself, you know that it's the better way because you have experienced it. Jesus is teaching people how to live in the world in a particular kind of way. The truth of this way of life will set you free, Jesus says, from serving yourself. It will set you free from thinking that faith is something that is only lived in your mind. Truth is so often mistaken for information or facts in religion. But for Jesus, truth is one of experience. It's something that's placed in the context of your whole life and your whole being. It's the way that you walk and see in the world. And in confirmation, we do talk about this. We talk about how God is not an argument. God is not a set of belief statements. We as human beings, we want something bigger. We want something more to live into. We want to experience love and forgiveness. We just don't want to talk about them. We want to be shaped by that, and we want to shape others with it. We want to do something about injustice and celebrate beauty. So metaphorically, maybe this will help get at this a little bit deeper. I mean, it's one thing to go to a nice restaurant, sit down, look at the menu, and just talk about what's on it. It's an entirely another thing to go sit down at a restaurant, look at the menu, but then actually enjoy the meal, the act of eating. We want to taste. So today, outside of celebrating confirmation, we also celebrate Reformation. It's Reformation Sunday. And that day is a particular day in our church celebration that we remember that we are constantly changing, always reforming. And why do we change? Why do we become different? Because we want the goodness of God's grace and mercy to be experienced more and more fully by others, and we need to be able to change in order to do that as our context changes. People want to practice a faith, a way of being in the world that is deep. And we as a church must always be aware of how we are or are not doing that. People are looking for a path to walk on, not just talk about. And if we go to a faith community and all we get is a massive, giant, intellectual kind of exercise that doesn't really mean anything for how we live in our life, then we've missed Jesus' message completely. I mean, God is not an argument. Joy and compassion and generosity and forgiveness, I mean, these things really aren't a debate. They are lived experience. And so Jesus says, live like I am teaching you to live. And when you do this, you will find freedom, a fullness of life that God intends for creation. And so today, may you know the truth from firsthand experience, because you've seen it, because you've experienced it, because you've felt it. And may you share this with others so that they might experience the story of the faith that we affirm today. And that is the good news that we hear. Thanks be to God for that. Amen. Once again, I'm going to invite the congregation to rise as you are able, as our worship continues in song.
You say I am. You are for me, not
Our service continues as we affirm the promises made to us in baptism. I ask us to stay standing for just a brief time. We join our hearts in prayer. Merciful God, we give you thanks for those gathered here that you've made your own by water and the word and baptism. You have called these people to yourself, enlightened them with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promise of baptism, and unite the hearts of all who you've brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, to the congregation, I ask us all to confess our faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin and confess the faith of this gathered community. And we start first by what we do not believe in. So do you renounce all the forces that defy God? If so, say together, I renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? If so, say, I renounce them. Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw us from God? If so, say, I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. I now ask everybody except the confirmation students to be seated. Confirmation students, stay standing, please. So, students, you have made public profession of your faith. I have some questions for you now. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If that is your intention today, I ask you to respond with these words: I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. We're on the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. Very good. And then, people of God, the community gathered around these young people today, do you promise to support these sisters and brothers in Christ and pray for them on a regular basis? If so, answer, we do, and we ask God to help and guide us. One, two, three. We do, and we ask God to help and guide us. Confirmation students, I invite you to be seated at this time. Our service of affirmation of baptism now continues with the actual blessing for each one of these students. And just so I can explain this to the congregation who's gathered here today, family and friends, what will happen is that our confirmation students will be ushered up two at a time, one family on each corner. Their family will surround them, and by family, it's whoever you want to bring up with you. It could be just your parents, grandparents, it could be everybody in your row, it doesn't matter. But they will surround you, and they will extend an arm in blessing, touching either your shoulder or something close to you, and there will be a blessing that will be spoken to you as you affirm these promises of your faith. When your blessing is done, you as a family will get up and return to your seats by the side aisle. So we'll have a new family then come and fill in the spot here using the center aisle. So the flow will be from the center, out, around to the edges, and then back to your seats. And again, you will be ushered forward. As a reminder, students, please have your card with you in your hand when you come up for your blessing. Our service continues.
They're going to go first and then we'll go.
If you want to, yes, hands on shoulders, that's just fine. Family, you can do the same. Gather around. You can hand on a shoulder or just arms outstretched, just like that. And we offer this blessing. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up and clear the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Connor the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Elise the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Ella the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Aaron the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Haley the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Henry the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Ian the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Isabel the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Julia the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Justin the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Nathan the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, and give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen. I'll give this back to you.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up and land in the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in PJ the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith and guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Nicholas the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Riley the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith and guide his life, empower him in his serving. Give him patience in suffering and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen. Here you go.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Raina the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving. Give her patience in suffering and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Sienna the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Sam the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Alexander the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith and guide his life. Empower him in his serving. Give him patience in suffering and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Zachary the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life. Empower him in his serving. Give him patience in suffering and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Blake the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith and guide his life. Empower him in his serving. Give him patience in suffering and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Kaya the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Caleb the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith and guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Charlie the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Brooke the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. In Jesus' name, amen.
We thank you, confirmation families, parents, for walking with your kids on every step of life, for helping them to remember their baptismal name, which is Child of God, for the many names that we receive in life, some good, some not. Child of God is our baptismal name that we remember and take with us no matter where we find ourselves in life. And so we now acclaim the promises that they have made today, and we do so as a congregation with the words printed on the screen. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. I invite the congregation to rise as you are able, as our service continues in prayer.
We join our hearts in prayer. We pray for the people in our lives and for all who are joined by bonds of marriage, family, and friendship. We pray for communities everywhere, for the nations, for all those who govern, and for justice and peace throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who love easily and for those with whom we struggle, for those different from us, and for those familiar to us, that we might be instruments of God's peace. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who suffer in any way, and those who are lonely, the dying, and those who are bereaved. Today, we especially pray for Jane and Curtis Anderson and the death of Jane's father. We pray also for those who are poor, hungry, homeless, or unemployed, for the victims of violence, hatred, and intolerance, and all whose lives have been impacted by violence, natural disasters, abuse, or anything that causes life to be less than you intend for your good creation. We pray that we would be inspired to give ourselves and our resources to aid those in need. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who are sick in their bodies, minds, or spirits, that they might find healing even if they cannot be cured. Today, we remember before you Jolene Perkins, Ralph Searles, Monica Anderson, Kristen Markfort, Dawn Tucker, Dale Hendrickson, Rosie Moe, Cammie Newby, Merle Ernest, Anne and John Ostendorf, and Samson Sarclay. Creator of all, you make us in your image and likeness and give us life. Hear the prayers of your people and the cries of this world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Every time we gather here and we hear God's word of grace, compassion, mercy, and love proclaimed, and put that into action, we find peace with God and peace with one another. So hearing that right now, the peace of the Lord be with you all. We share a sign of God's peace with our neighbors around us, either through a handshake or through arms outstretched. We share God's peace. I do invite the congregation to please be seated. Everything that we have is a gift that comes to us from God, and out of thankfulness, we give back for the sake of God's mission in this time and place, the mission that this church is committed to living into as we serve one another and our community. That is only made possible through your gifts of your time, your passions, your talents, and of your finances. Thank you for the many ways in which you share of yourself for the sake of our shared mission in this place. We will receive our tithes and offerings at this time. We will also at this time ask that you find the black pad that is on the edge of your pew. It's going to be in a book rack below you. Community is so very important to us at Bethlehem. And one of the ways that we try to maintain our community is through just seeing who is engaging with us in worship. Also, you'll find yellow inserts in this. If there's anybody that you would like us to pray for over the coming days, weeks, or months, please fill that out, get it to us, and we'll be sure to add them in prayer. We now receive our tithes and offerings. Hear an offering of music.
That
Invite the congregation to rise as you are able as we prepare to gather around the Lord's table. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The story of God's grace, mercy, compassion, and love continues. As we remember, in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Together we pray the prayer that our Lord has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I invite the congregation to please be seated. Come, for all is ready. Here at Bethlehem, you are all welcome to come to the Lord's table. The table is set by Christ, and if you receive communion in your faith tradition, if you are visiting us, you are welcome at this table. Come as your faith allows. We will be serving communion in three stations, two in the front, one on the side. Ushers will direct you towards the correct station. When you get there, you will receive a piece of bread and then have the option to choose from a cup of red wine or white grape juice. When you are finished with your cup, you'll place it in the basket that will be provided to you and return to your seat. If you get up and are not sure where to go, follow the person in front of you. You will be okay. We'll get there. Come, for all is ready.
the body. his feet going? Why is his love not showing them there is a way? There is a way. A traveler is far away from home. He sheds his coat.
I invite the congregation to rise once more.
Let us join our hearts in prayer. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
And now, as we prepare to leave this place today, take God's blessing back out into the world, into your life, into your places of work, your schools, your community, your family, and circle of friends. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Unveil thy will made, concern our hearts of clay.
Go in peace, the living word dwells in you. Thanks be to God.